Welcome to our Pilgrimage of Hope, where we prepare for Jubilee 2025. On tonight's episode, we are exploring the topic of holy doors. Let's take a listen to what the average layperson had to say.
Never heard what is a Jubilee door?
Yes, I have heard about the door. I know that there's one in the cathedral and in the pro-cathedral. And to me, it represents hope as well, which goes together with the theme that the Pope has selected for this year.
I am aware in Forest Lane, I did not know
Correct.
About salt.
I wasn't aware. Usually have in the cathedral,
No, I haven't.
Right, well, the door concept is like what water is in baptism. As you pass through it, you are cleansed, you are refreshed, you get a new start. And in Rome, there are doors that are only opened in a Jubilee year. They closed all the time, but when a Jubilee year comes, that door is opened, and then the community, the pilgrims, the Catholics, anybody can pass through that door, and it gives them, it is the symbol of the cleansing and the new start.
To me, a Jubilee door is like, first of all, you have to know what you're entering into. You have to be aware of what is on the other side.
Years ago when I went to the Jubilee year, it had this door in front of a door. So when you're coming through the church, there's a next door set up. And you have to pass through that door. So I end up going through that some years back.
Door opening, ushering in something great, you know, joy. Opening people to enter into something great, I believe, I guess. I don't know. I don't know if it's a metaphorical door, if it's something that's going to be within each specific church, but I think it's some sort of ushering, stepping from one way into the next.
I hope to be in Rome for this Jubilee coming up 2025, because I always pass through the Mercy Door at that time. So that's when they open the Mercy Door. Even in Port of Spain, they open the Mercy Door. So I'll be in our cathedral here, maybe in San Fernando, but I want to be in Rome.
She's also asking archdioceses across the world to put in doors, Jubilee doors, where their faithful who cannot travel to Rome can pass through. And I understand there are plans for Port of Spain, the cathedral in Port of Spain, and also the Pro Cathedral in San Fernando.
Tonight we're joined on set by a very interesting group of persons, and I want to ask them just to introduce themselves.
So, hi everyone, my name is Ayana Walters from the Santa Rosa Malabar Cluster.
I'm Deanne Bertrand from Our Lady of Montserrat in Tortuga.
To my right, we have...
Hi, I'm Cathy Ann Martin-Jones, representing St. Francis of Assisi, Sangre Grande.
Hi, I'm Damian Harris from the Santa Rosa Malabar Cluster in Arima.
So from what we've heard so far, there's quite a bit of ambiguity around this topic of holy doors. So we want to turn now to Father Don just to add some clarity, as he usually does. Over to you, Father Don.
A door is a metaphor for the human heart. Our hearts open and shelter others from abusive, violent, or cruel spaces and relationships. For example, the hearts of parents, teachers, and mentors are like doors through which persons enter to experience the warmth and the care of an embrace, words of wisdom, or simply a calming presence. Like an open door, the heart is meant to be flexible, indiscriminately inviting people to enter freely to provide hospitality to those who enter. Pope Francis dreams that during the Jubilee year, the church will encounter Jesus Christ as the true door of salvation who renews our hope. He writes, "For everyone, may the Jubilee be a moment of genuine personal encounter with the Lord Jesus, the door, the door of our salvation, whom the church is charged to proclaim always, everywhere, and to all as our hope. In the Catholic tradition, we speak of sacramentals. Sacramentals are sacred signs to prepare us to receive the fruit of the sacraments and to sanctify different circumstances of life. For example, the crucifix, rosaries, candles, and all things, persons and places blessed to praise God and to lead persons to a deeper relationship with God are sacramentals. In the Jubilee year, the doors of holy places, such as cathedrals and co-cathedrals, are to be used as sacramentals. According to Pope Francis, now the time has come for a new Jubilee, when once more the holy door will be flung open to invite everyone to an intense experience of the love of God that awakens in hearts the sure hope of salvation in Christ. As sacramentals, the holy doors invite and prepare us to receive the fruits of our encounter with Jesus Christ and sanctify our journey and actions of hope during the Jubilee year. Consequently, at the beginning of the Jubilee year, the Holy Father will symbolically open the doors of the Mother Church in Rome and other basilicas. In turn, the bishops of every diocese are instructed to open the doors of cathedrals and co-cathedrals in their dioceses. The opening of the holy doors, like the starter's gun, signals the beginning of the Jubilee year. It replaces the ram's horn of the Hebrew scripture. As pilgrims of hope, we are reminded of St. Paul's appeal to the Christian community in Thessalonica. We are about to make a pilgrimage marked by great events, in which the grace of God precedes and accompanies his people as they press forward firm in faith, active in charity, and steadfast in hope. Consequently, the Holy Father will open the holy door of the Basilica of St. Peter in the Vatican on the 24th December 2024 to inaugurate the Jubilee year. The holy door of the Pope's Cathedral, St. John's Lateran, will be opened on Sunday, December 29th, 2024. Then on January 1, 2025, on the Solemnity of Mary, Mother of God, the holy door of the Basilica of St. Mary the Major will be opened. And then on January 5th, 2025, the holy door of the Basilica of St. Paul outside the walls will be opened. Finally, on December 29th, 2024, diocesan bishops will open the doors of every cathedral and co-cathedral and celebrate masses marking the solemn opening of the Jubilee year in their dioceses. But why is the church opening the doors of cathedrals of the various dioceses? In the Catholic tradition, the cathedral is the mother church in the diocese. The doors of cathedrals and co-cathedrals are holy because they are sacramentals that lead pilgrims of hope to enter, to rest, to reflect, and to renew themselves in the presence of the heart of Christ in the Blessed Sacrament. Therefore, the holy doors of the cathedrals and co-cathedrals and holy shrines, like a mother's heart, welcome her weary and overburdened pilgrim children to rest on her sacred lap and to drink from her sacred breast milk, the milk of hope. So during the Jubilee year, These holy doors will allow pilgrims of hope to enter and listen to Christ's words, "Come, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." With hope renewed, pilgrims of hope will be strengthened to become doors of hope for the weak and vulnerable, the sick, the young, the elderly, prisoners, refugees, migrants, the poor, and impoverished nations overburdened by economic death. May the doors of our hearts as pilgrims of hope become as holy as Christ's door is holy. May we, during the Jubilee year, open the doors of our hearts to those who are weak and vulnerable and renew their hope.
To start us off this evening in our conversation here on set, I want to open the floor just to ask you all to respond with some bit of clarity that might have come to you after hearing Father Don's teaching just now.
Okay, so for me, the word encounter stuck with me. So the door is symbolic as a sacramental, as he was explaining, to kind of encourage Catholics, Christians to enter the church to encounter Jesus, God, in the church, and as well, we could be vessels of encounter for persons on the street. Mm-hmm. So that's what I took away from his teaching.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. For me, well, I latched on to certain things and went off into my own contemplation, so I hope you don't mind. But he spoke about the heart of Jesus in the Eucharist, and as we all know, Jesus resides, his heart, his sacred heart resides in the tabernacle of our churches. And so this is where I went off, because I kind of thought of Jesus saying, you know, destroy this temple and I will raise it up in 3 days. Mm-hmm. And I have always thought about that reading as Jesus not only being the body of Christ in the warm bodies, mm-hmm. ourselves, but also being the temple.
Yeah.
And so I always contemplated the idea of the door of the church being like the opening of the holy door, being the church, say opening the wound of the side of Jesus's body, because the temple is also Jesus's body. And out of that wound on his side poured graces and, you know, the sacraments and all of the things which nourish us as his children. And so I feel that the Pope opening the holy door is like opening the wound in the side of Christ and inviting us all to come in and feast on the sacraments and all of the goodness that flows from Jesus' side. And of course, to sit in the presence of his heart, his sacred heart in the tabernacle. So that, as Father spoke so beautifully about the holy door, that's where I went. Went off into that whole concept of Jesus being body of us and also temple, and the church in its wisdom opening the wound in his side so that we could feast again on all of the graces that poured out of his side and sit in his holy presence and the beating of his heart in the tabernacle.
I want to just go on a little bit with what Diana said exactly with the, you know, Jesus' presence in the tabernacle there, mm-hmm. and the symbol. The opening of the door is like a physical act of a sacramental symbol for us, because when we enter into the church, or we enter into that space where Jesus lives in the tabernacle, we're there to get to reconcile. We're there for mercy. We're there for grace. So opening the doors, the holy doors, inviting people, inviting the community, inviting all people to receive Jesus in that way, and, you know, and reconcile with him. Anybody, everybody is welcome. Because it does not open it to us Catholics, it's open to everybody, the entire world, wherever you are in this world, and one of your cathedrals, the doors are open for you to come and meet Jesus there, you know, present in the Blessed Sacrament.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Kind of lost here, but everybody took everything I was going to say. So, Holy Father would have repeated, he was quite clear in terms of it being sacramental. But I, on my own understanding, it is more, let's not look at the physical attributes of this Jubilee door or this Holy Door. Yes, it's a door to our heart, but I understand it to mean Jesus is opening his door to re-invite us. We have been invited before, mm-hmm. but to re-invite us. I mean, at times we step out that door for whatever reason. And that invitation, it extends. Sometimes we think that if the door is closed, you know, I mean, life, when the door is closed, we think we cannot re-enter through that door. That is not the case in this time. But also, we have closed the door so much on a number of issues and persons in terms of family, in terms of how we treat the elderly, how we treat the youth, how we treat. We have closed doors, and I take it as the invitation to reopen those doors in terms of communication, how we really operate as Catholics and as Christians within the church. I think sometimes our hearts, that door is also closed to Christ.
Yeah.
And that could really be something. So as much as it's sacramental, it represents everything that everyone has said, yes. But really is to really open our door to Christ, but also to open, not just to Christ, open the door to others. And remember that Christ, again, is in re-inviting us to enter through his door.
Yeah. So. I really appreciate the imagery and the varying perspectives that you all bring to the floor. Beautiful imagery with the wound of Jesus through which salvation comes. And by opening that wound, he's opening the door for all believers to experience that salvation. It's really beautiful. And then Derek is inviting us to look beyond the physical door. But you also use two terms somewhat interchangeably just now, the Jubilee door and the Holy Door. Is that clear for us? Are those terms interchangeable based on what Father Don was saying?
I would say no. So there's holy doors in Rome, but the doors that would be in the other dioceses across the world would be marked as Jubilee doors.
Right.
So that's what I got from the distinction there. The holy door is the one, I could be wrong, but the Basilica of St. Peter. So that one is the Holy Door. But like what we would have in Trinidad would be a Jubilee Door in our archdiocese.
Yeah, he actually outlined quite a few, maybe about five or six of doors that will be opened in Rome.
Yeah.
In
right.
The Basilica
yes,
is around St. Peter's
Correct.
First on the 24th of mm-hmm. December.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
I listed some other dates about the other doors.
The
and then here in our archdiocese, in our cathedrals across the world on the 29th of December,
mm-hmm.
these Jubilee Doors, like
yes.
I said, will be opened.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, it's good. I want to ask you all for your insight upon the purpose of going through the door. And yes, the invitation of going through the door is to bring salvation, but is it a mystical transformation? You just show up at a cathedral, you show up at a church with a Jubilee door, and you just walk through and your life has changed. What do you all think happens
if,
there?
If that's the case, sign me up. I'm in front.
I will actually have to build it.
But no, definitely, you know, with all things, we need to work on ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And if we get in the opportunity to come in his presence, so then we have to change our minds and our hearts and the way we think and the things that we do, you know, so what we do will align with the goodness that would be and the graces that would be given to us when we come into, you know, when we walk through those doors.
Yeah.
So definitely
that is also
change.
Why the Pope named this year 2024 a year of prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Because like the Jubilee in 2000, 3 years before, each year was dedicated Father, Son, Holy Spirit, all
yes.
for the church to prepare over those 3 years
and come to wholeness in the Trinity and then enter into the Jubilee of 2000.
Yes.
And in this scenario, the Pope in his wisdom, and the church is always so deeply wise, named this year the year of prayer and asked all of us to deepen our prayer and through that our preparation, so that by the time you get through the door, you aligned, your mind and your spirit is aligned with the journey that you have traversed.
Yeah.
And then, you know, in anticipation for the gifts that are waiting for you as you go through the door. So it's not magical thinking, because the church isn't into magical thinking.
That's true.
Every gift that we claim in Jesus' name has to be worked for.
Yeah.
On yourself, introspection, reconciliation, forgiveness, as Damien said.
Yes.
You know, all of it. But this year of prayer has been a significant gift from the church so that we'll be ready to receive the gifts in 2025.
Awesome. So you listed introspection and reconciliation.
Yes.
And prayer. Well, what are some of the practical ways persons can engage in that prayer journey? What are some of the ways that you have engaged in that prayer journey to help you prepare for Jubilee 2025?
Well, not so much to help me prepare for Jubilee 2025, but it's my own personal everyday. I have a set time. I wake up in the morning, so I do these prayers, and then I look for, you know, scenes of the day, or I look for the feast that we may be celebrating, and I focus on that throughout the day. So it's definitely a personal journey for me. You know, building up for, so that when we reach into 2025, I'm already in a mindset that I'm just ready to receive great graces that would be, you know, that Jesus so anxiously waiting to give me more.
Yeah.
You know, but on the journey, definitely, when you prepare yourself, I mean, you have your own prayers, even just the Our Father, you say, now this is what you want to see alone that will prepare you prepare your life, whatever you have. And whatever you do, that is what is preparing you for Jubilee 2025. So I don't know if anybody has any special thing that they do it, but every day is the same. It's a journey for me. Wake up with a structured, I kind of like structure. Wake up with a structured way of praying, doing my meditations and that kind of thing, and just aligning it with the church's teachings and the church's celebrations, so that when Jubilee comes around, Jubilee 2025 come along, you know, I'm really in a mindset to celebrate as well.
Yeah. Okay.
Damien, you want to speak about
it? Then my thoughts are trying hard to contain the thoughts around me. So, we are portals, regardless we say that we are not, right? So, we can be considered as doors. I mean, people interact with us, come through us, and whatever it was. We all have our varying responsibilities and what have you. In terms of how much we facilitate the process is another thing. I think if we are aware, that's the first part, and that's maybe half the story done there. In our awareness, how do we action that? How do we now? So it's just like having your plan, and what do you do? You operationalize your plan. So as we as portals, even in everything, how do we allow persons, what type of interaction we provide for others? Because we could focus on ourselves. Listen to me, my mother probably have arthritis from praying for me, and still, Moses never learned the Bible. So I could be selfish a bit and real pray for myself, but I think a couple of these saints and people kind of pray for me a bit.
Mm-hmm.
But do I extend that to other people? You understand? Like, what do I do to facilitate, to allow others to experience? What about the people who are not aware?
Mm-hmm.
What do I do? So, mostly for me, the focus is a little more about being that portal for persons, being the allowing persons to have, if not the same encounter, I have even greater ones. Even it is at my expense, because that is what we are called to do.
Yeah.
And in, even though yeah, the prayer, I mean, sometimes we really don't focus and forget. Well, me, all that. But I like to pray, and I pray when I'm in trouble, like honest Catholic. I pray when I need something. So it's trying not to be selfish in the prayer, and really, it's not rocket science, it's just it.
Yeah.
Well, I was saying the church also gives us so many wonderful mechanisms for prayer, and it is varied based on personality. So we have things like contemplation and the Blessed Sacrament, adoration. But we also have the rosary, which is like the lasso. You lasso all the demons with the rosary, and you pray for people with the rosary through the heart of Mary, through the Immaculate Heart, to Jesus' Sacred Heart. And then you have Mass. You the highest form of prayer we have is Mass. So for me this year, I tried to embrace more of the avenues provided by the church. So if I was doing before rosary mainly every day, I tried to go to church every day. I tried to do Eucharistic adoration once a week so that, you know, I could expose myself to all of the different mechanisms given to us by the church, but also to try and pray some more because, you know, we could get into a habit of prayer where it's just an exercise.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
And then you say, hey, Mary, for the grace of God,
Exactly.
You know, so that's what I did. I just expanded to some of the other ways that the church has taught us to pray so that, you know, I could get through the year.
Let's add me on your prayer list, please.
Just going to Damien here. And, you know, you say, like, to pray, Father, to remember others as well in prayer, not just being selfish. And this is where I am a staunch believer of novenas. Novenas are my passion.
Really?
Novenas are my passion. My sister and I'm like, Kathy said, the next novena. Because I adore, I really feel so closer to our saints and to Jesus when I pray, and to our mother. I pray when I do the novenas. I love novenas. So, as you said, you just expand your knowledge in the different avenues that the church is offering to us, because there's so much, our faith is so filled with so much beautiful things that we could draw closer to Jesus. And
correct.
And when you take, for example, like I said, the novena, and you in that now you pray for others, because you're not just praying for yourself in the novenas.
Correct.
Yeah?
Yes.
Yeah. So it sounds like an intentional heart, really. Is at the crux of it all.
Yes.
Whether it's an intentional heart to go through the Holy Door to receive the graces, an intentional heart to improve ourselves or to become more aware of ourselves or our connection with God, an intentional heart seems to be at the crux of what's important for this journey of hope.
Yes,
whether
it's
through the door or journeying with our families or with each other, an intentional heart. So I want to thank you all for the very spirited conversation and the way that you contributed so richly and beautifully here this evening. I want to thank you viewers for joining us again tonight. And I want to encourage you to join us again next week, Monday at 8 p.m. right here on Trinity TV and on our Catholic TT platforms. Thank you as well to Father Don, as usual, for his insightful talks and the way that he break opens the topics for us. Join us again next week. Thanks, and see you then.
If you can raise your eyes to the horizons of renewal and restoration, if you can open your ears to the voice of the Beloved who calls you to hope and not despair, if you can reach out and forgive, heal and restore in spite of the hurt and darkness, then you would realize a jubilee of hope and restoration for our world. And you would have made a journey of hope. Join us in this pilgrimage of hope as it becomes a reality in the life of the church. And truly, it will be a jubilee to celebrate.